Okay, hi. I'm going to talk about the list recoverability of randomly punctured codes. This is joint work with Ben Lund. Ben is soon going to start his postdoc at Institute for Basic Science. First, some preliminaries. The main focus of this talk are going to be query codes of length n. So codes over alphabets of size q, and I'm thinking of q as large, size comparable to n. Some standard coding theory notation I'll also use. The rate of C is the log of size of C base Q divided by N. And the distance of C is the minimum relative Hamming distance between any two points in the code. BRX is a Hamming ball of radius R centered at X. BRS for a set S is a Hamming ball of radius R around the set S. A running example that might that is going to be interesting for everything I will talk about is a degree D Reed-Solomon code over FQ. In fact, even degree 1 Reed-Solomon codes over FQ are interesting for whatever I'm about to talk about. So if you've not seen list recoverable codes before, here's a quick overview. So what is a usual error correcting code setting? You have a message M, you encode it into say Y using some error correcting code, and you pass it through a noisy channel, and you get some corrupted code word Y prime. And I'm talking about the worst case error. So all you have is a guarantee on the distance between y and y prime. And you want codes so that when you decode y prime, it uniquely decodes to the intended message m. Right? One key difference in this setting is that every coordinate of y prime is corrupted. So every alphabet of y prime is slightly corrupted. You can narrow down every coordinate to some possibilities, but you don't know exactly what they are. But you can narrow down every coordinate to very few possibilities. So that's one advantage you have. This formally, what does it mean? A code C is said to be row, little l, capital L, list recoverable. If for every S1, S2, so on, SN, subsets of Q, the alphabet, each of size at most little l, the number of code words in a Hamming ball of radius row n around S1 cross, S2 cross, so on, SN is at most capital L. So that's what these parameters mean. The row here refers to the fraction of errors that you can tolerate. The little l is the size of each SI, as a bound on the size of each SI. And capital L is a bound on the size of C intersection B row n of S1 cross S2 cross so on SN. So here little l is called the input list size and capital L is called the output list size. So there is some trade-off between all three parameters, but for the most part, I will assume that rho is either some, it's just some fixed constant. I won't care much about what exactly rho is. In fact, the case when rho is zero is also interesting, and that's called zero error list recoverable, which is an important special case and will be a considerable part of the focus of this talk. So because it's going to be important, I'll just state it explicitly. What is zero error list recoverability? This is a condition that we want. For every S1, S2, so on, SN subsets of Q, such that each of these lists is of size at most little l, the number of code words in S1 cross S2 cross so on SN is at most capital L. This is what it means for a code to be little l comma capital L, zero error list recoverable. And these are the codes contained in S1, S2, so on, SN. So given this definition, a goal of sorts is to construct codes which can take as many errors as much corruption as possible and output relatively efficiently. So we want to construct codes where little l is large and capital L is small as a function of little l. So what does small mean? It's at most poly l. You can also ask that the output list is at most the input list times 1 plus little o of 1. Think for a few seconds and you see you need to allow that the output list is at least the input list. But the point is you can ask for something that's not much worse than the trivial lower bound that you need. So here's some basic background on list recoverability. It's called the Johnson bound. It says the following. For any code of distance 1 minus epsilon, the code is list recoverable from constant fraction of errors from lists of size around 1 over epsilon. So if C has distance 1 minus epsilon, it is omega 1 little l capital L list recoverable, where the input list is order 1 over epsilon, and the output list is a linear function of input list. Right? So what does this translate to in the example? It says that read Solomon codes of rate epsilon, because I'm saying distance 1 minus epsilon and they're read Solomon codes of rate epsilon are list recoverable from constant fraction errors from list sizes 1 over epsilon. So whenever we see read Solomon codes like this, we know a lot of algebraic structure about read Solomon codes, and they have a lot more structure than, say, any code for which the Johnson bound applies. So an obvious question one can ask is that, are all read Solomon codes actually better than this? For example, in this statement, can I replace 1 over epsilon here by 1 over epsilon squared? Right? Because using all the additional structure that I think read Solomon codes have. Another question, okay, forget about all codes. Is there any read Solomon code where I can replace 1 over epsilon by 1 over epsilon squared of rate epsilon? Right? So I still get all the algebraic structure that read Solomon codes have, but I can go beyond the Johnson bound in the sense I can list recover from lists of size more than what the Johnson bound guarantees. So these are two questions one can ask at this point. And a quick spoiler, the answer to the first question is no, and the answer to the second question is yes. And this work mostly focuses on the second question. Before I state the main theorem, here's the last bit of notation. Let C be a code and M be a set of indices. A punctured code, an M punctured code denoted by C subscript M, is just the code words in C except only at quad indices in M. Right? So you write down all the code words in C, but you only write the indices which are there in M. That is the M punctured code C. So as an example, again, we'll go back to read Solomon codes. Let M be any subset of the field FQ. The degree D read Solomon code with evaluation set M is just this, the evaluation of all degree at most D polynomials at all the points in M. And that is a read Solomon code of degree D and evaluation set M. So in some sense, read Solomon codes are also punctured codes. Right? And here's the main result. Is that for fix any alpha greater than zero, like think of alpha as like 0.01, like any small fixed constant, any code C over alphabet of size Q and distance at least 1 minus 1 over Q minus epsilon squared can be punctured to rate something like epsilon over log Q so that it is list recoverable from constant fraction errors and list size 1 over epsilon squared, right? So any just having a bound on the distance of the code means you can puncture it to a much better rate so that it is list recoverable from lists of size 1 over epsilon squared. As a corollary, there are read Solomon codes of rate epsilon over log Q that can be list recovered from constant fraction errors and list size 1 over epsilon squared. So it's an extremely straightforward corollary because read Solomon codes of rate there are read Solomon codes of such so much rate and you can puncture them down to this rate which you also get read Solomon codes which are list recoverable for this parameters. And the way this theorem is proved is that a random puncturing does this with high probability. So that is a kind of proof flavor that is going to happen. Okay. So to put this into context, recall the corollary again. There are read Solomon codes of rate epsilon over log Q that can be list recovered from constant fraction errors and list sizes 1 over epsilon squared, right? So compare this to what the Johnson bound says. It says every read Solomon code of rate epsilon over log Q can be list recovered from constant fraction of errors, but list size 1 over epsilon times log Q. So for epsilon smaller than log Q, this says that there are read Solomon codes that are list recoverable beyond the Johnson bound. So here beyond the Johnson bound means can be list recovered efficiently from list sizes larger than what the Johnson bound guarantees. So here is some background. A kind of a similar line of results have been proven about something called list decodability. So what is list decodability? A code C is said to be row L list decodable if for every point in Qn, the number of code words in a Hamming ball of radius rho n around the point is at most capital L. So that is said to be rho comma L is decodable. If every point has very few code words around in a Hamming ball around it. Okay, and this thing called Johnson bound is a very similar kind of argument. So it's also called a Johnson bound here, but it's a very similar kind of argument. Just that it's a very similar flavor of statement too, which says any QRE code of distance 1 minus 1 over Q minus epsilon squared is list decodable from 1 minus order epsilon fraction of errors and list size 1 over epsilon, right? So again, just by having a bound on the distance guarantees some kind of list decodability. It's kind of very similar to the kind of Johnson bound that we saw previously. Here's a theorem by Rudra and Wooters, which is every QRE code of distance 1 minus 1 over Q minus epsilon squared can be punctured to rate around epsilon over log Q so that you can list decode it from 1 minus order epsilon fraction errors and list size 1 over epsilon. And Johnson bound only guaranteed 1 over square root epsilon for such rate. So one of the main points of this work is that there are Reed Solomon codes that can be list decoded beyond the Johnson bound. Here, beyond the Johnson bound means that can be list decoded from a larger fraction of errors than what the Johnson bound guarantees. There's one key difference though. Recall question one. You can also ask, is every Reed Solomon code list recoverable beyond the Johnson bound? And I said the answer was no. And this was a theorem by Guruswamy and Rudra. So in the case of list recoverability, this is false. Every Reed Solomon code cannot be list decoded beyond the Johnson bound. On the other hand, the same question, question one prime, is every Reed Solomon code list decodable beyond the Johnson bound? And the answer here is that we don't know. So that is one key difference. So here's even more motivation for list recoverability, which has to do with these graphs called unbalanced expanders. So given a code C, we use GC to denote the following graph, right? It's a bipartite graph. The left side is much larger than the right side, as I kind of tried to illustrate. The left side, the vertices are given by all the code words. And on the right side, the vertices are given by the alphabet cross 1 to N. Okay. And how do I put the edges? It's for a code word X, which is given by X1, X2, so on, XN. You connect X to X1, 1, X2, 2, so on, XN, N. So that's how you put the edges. The degree of every vertex on the left is N, because surely you only put X, a vertex on the left has only edges to its coordinates on the right. The goal here of sorts is to find codes such that this graph that you construct from it is a KD epsilon unbalanced expander. So what does this mean? What do these parameters mean? Firstly, the D here refers to the degree of the vertices on the left. Every vertex on the left has degree D. That's what the D refers to. And for K and epsilon, it's the following. Take any subset of vertices S on the left of size at most K, right? Its neighborhood size is at least D times size of S times 1 minus epsilon. So it can be at most D times size of S because the degree is at most D. But if epsilon is small, this is asking for graphs where it has pretty much around DS many neighbors. So this is what the KD epsilon unbalanced expander graph is. And here's one of the places where fixing D equal to 1 is also extremely interesting. Pick a set of evaluation points M and consider the degree D Reed Solomon code. Like just think of degree 1 Reed Solomon codes with some set of evaluation points M, right? In fact, I'm thinking of choosing M uniformly from all sets of size some little m. And I'll call the distribution of these codes as RSM. So this is a distribution of Reed Solomon codes of a fixed degree. So here's a question. What is the smallest M such that GRSM, which is, again, now this is a random graph given by the probability inherited here. What is the smallest M such that GRSM is an unbalanced expander with high probability, which means that every set of size order Q has M times, around M times Q many neighbors. This question was also stated explicitly in a recent paper by Chen and Zuckerman. But this, and I don't think this question as it is was written down before this. I mean, I'm not aware of much existing literature where this stuff was written down. But I guess more or less, it's kind of a folklore conjecture, is that you need a log Q is sufficient. The constants here are allowed to depend on D. That's why I'm fixing D. D is one is also interesting. But this is a conjecture that as a function of Q, it should be something like log Q. Again, this is also known that you need at least log Q. We couldn't find either of the conjecture or this in previous literature, but the fact that M is at least log Q is there in this paper. So, and there's more than one way to do this too. So, the corollary implies that M is at most order square root Q. So it's not quite log Q, but apparently nothing better than the trivial Q was known. And this gives some kind of non-trivial improvement over that bound. Okay, so again, so what does this have to do anything with list recoverability? It's almost a syntactic translation of the conditions. It's almost. It's very easy to check that the following. C is L, L times 1 plus epsilon 0 error list recoverable if and only if GC is an L N epsilon unbalanced expander. So it's a very straightforward translation of a property. So there's not much difficulty here. And because we prove a bound on this list recoverability, that translates immediately to a property on the unbalanced expanders. Okay. So I'll talk a bit about the proof sketch. First, let me just recall the main theorem. It's fix any alpha greater than zero, like again, point one. Any code C, QRE code, of distance at least 1 minus 1 over Q minus epsilon squared can be punctured to rate something like epsilon over log Q so that it can be list recoverable from a constant fraction of errors and lists of size 1 over epsilon squared. So that's the theorem statement. And here's the starting point. Let M be the randomly chosen set of evaluation point. Like we're talking about M punctured codes, fix a set M, right? Suppose M was bad, that means suppose it did not have this list recoverability property that was claimed. What does this mean? It means that there are sets S1, S2, so on, Sm, such that the number of code words in the punctured code in the Hamming ball around S1 cross, S2 cross, so on, Sm is larger than L times 1 plus epsilon. So pictorially, what does it look like? So this is some kind of representation of Q cross M, right? So the columns are indexed by these evaluation points and the rows, the columns are the alphabet and each column corresponds to the alphabets in at an evaluation point. So this is Q cross M. And here are sets S1, S2, so on, Sm. And each SI is at most L. This is what happens. There are a lot of code words that mostly are contained in S1, S2, so on, up to Sm. So that is what this condition states, right? So you have more than L times 1 plus epsilon many code words. So this subset of code words corresponds to a bad event that, and of course, like you want no bad event to hold, right? So the probability of each bad event is something like e to the minus omega of m, right? So this is something that one can compute. But here's the thing, the number of bad events naively, so again, each subset of L times 1 plus epsilon code words corresponds to a bad event. If that's all, very naively, that just corresponds to a bound of size of C choose L times 1 plus epsilon, right? So if you just think of these as bad events, the naive bound is pretty bad, and this is too wasteful to do a union bound over. Okay, so let's get back. So what do we have? We have that there are sets S1, S2, so on, Sm, and each SI is at most a little L, and there are more than L times 1 plus epsilon many code words. Now the point is, because each SI is at most L, and there are more than L times 1 plus epsilon code words must agree with each other on a lot of places. So that's an observation. But the point is, you choose a random subset D prime of D. So let the set of these code words be D, when you choose a random subset D prime of D, random, and that's important here, and the size of D prime is something like square root size of D, the point is that the code words in D prime also have a large agreement probably. And this comes from something like the birthday paradox. Okay. So what is the upshot is that the bad events are now only indexed by D prime, right? So every set of D code words cannot be a bad event. So you further refine it by saying, okay, you only want set of code words where there's a much smaller subset of code words where something bad is happening. And no, these are the only bad events. And applying this previous naive bound to sets D prime gives that the number of bad events are the size of C choose square root L, which is much smaller than size of C choose L times 1 plus epsilon. And this is good enough to do union bound over. So that's all I'll say about the proof. Okay, here's the last slide. I just want to showcase this conjecture again. This is a pretty old conjecture, and I think this has been tried quite a bit. It's fix D and epsilon. A random puncturing of the degree D Reed-Solomon code of rate something like 1 over log Q is L, L times 1 plus epsilon, zero error list recoverable with high probability for L something like omega of Q, right? So this is the same conjecture that I stated in the language of graphs. This was a question of Guruswami, but yeah, stated in the context of codes now. Again, D is 1 and epsilon is 0.1 for all that matters here. So yeah, even there, and the point is that the degree 1 is interesting too, and this contains a lot of geometric, this is essentially a geometric problem. It's a lot of geometric information about lines and points over finite fields that we have here. And another comment is this information actually relevant? Like if I have another code of similar rate distance as a degree 1 Reed-Solomon code, does this conjecture still hold there? Like does random puncturing still do it? And yeah. So that's all I want to talk about. Thank you. If there's any question or feedback, please send them to me.